Swift News is relaunching in 2024. And for those that are new here, this is a show I started all the way back in 2018, where I share top stories, blog posts, videos, and just general happenings in the world of iOS dev, and then I give my thoughts and comments on it. Links to everything you see in the show is in the Swift News GitHub repo. You'll see the link to that in the description. Let's kick things off with a few quick-hitting news bites from Apple. And in case you've been living under a rock, Apple Vision Pro will launch February 2nd with pre-orders on Friday, January 19th. Now, I'm going to do everything I can to get one day one so I can provide some content for you about it. It's a nice little tax write-off for the YouTube business. And I'm going to make Creator View native on Vision OS. So stay tuned for a lot of Vision OS content from me coming up. And for those of you that are creating your own apps, Apple recently released a Q&A for spatial design for Vision OS. So you may have some questions on what it's like to develop for the Vision Pro. What's the best way to make a great first impression on the platform? What should I consider when bringing an existing iPad OS or iOS app to Vision OS? You know, I'm not going to sit here and read all of it, but anyway, this Q&A is a great place to start if you're wondering, where do I even start with my app to bring it to Vision OS? You know, I'll highlight one more here. You know, what's the easiest way to make a spatial computing design look polished? There's a whole bunch of questions that also point you to other WWDC videos. I know I'm super pumped for Vision OS. I know not everyone's fully bought in yet. Where are you at? What do you think about this? The next bit of Apple news is Apple released their App of the Year winners. Now, this site just points you to their App Store page, like here's all trails. But the reason I wanted to highlight this is back to the listing here, right? Here's the iPhone App of the Year, iPad Apps of the Year, and the finalists, the Mac apps. If you're building an app for one of these platforms or all the platforms, I highly recommend, let's use all trails that won the best iOS app of the year, go to their page, see what they're doing in their App Store screenshots, download the app, play with it, see what an App of the Year feels like to use, and you'll probably get a ton of ideas for the apps that you're building. So definitely check out these apps that won App of the Year for the various platforms. Next bit of news, we now get 25 hours of Xcode Cloud included with the Apple Developer Program. The Apple Developer Program is what you pay $99 a year for. When I was a little bonus, you get 25 hours of Xcode Cloud. Here is the Xcode Cloud pricing, right? 25 for free, 100 hours, 50 bucks a month, 250 compute hours, 99 a month. Here's how you can track your usage, everything, if you wanna dive into Xcode Cloud, but nice that we get a little bit for free. And then the last bit of news is a sneaky one. This is gonna apply to a lot of your apps, I bet. Upcoming third-party SDA requirements, and this is around privacy. So basically, you need to have a privacy manifest file, which here's the documentation for that. Again, links will be in the GitHub repo. And I'm gonna do a tutorial all about how to set up this privacy manifest file, because if you're using one of these third-party SDKs, like look at the list, you're probably using one of these, right? Alamo Fire, Kingfisher, Lottie, MB Progress Hub, all the Facebook stuff, all the Firebase stuff, RX Swift, SD Web Image, Swifty JSON, Google Sign In. So these are very common third-party libraries. So if you're using one of these starting in spring of 2024, you must include the privacy manifest in any SDK listed below. And again, if you want the documentation, I'll have a link to that here, but I will have a tutorial on my YouTube channel all about this when the time comes. Next up, I have a blog post from Bruno Rocha of Swift Rocks. There is no right or wrong in software engineering. And this is, right, have you ever seen preachings like this on Twitter or whatever? If you're not using X in 2023, you're an idiot. XYZ architecture is the only way to go. Doing this in Swift, stop immediately. And these are all ridiculous because, as the title of the blog post says, like there's no right or wrong. And I get tagged in these questions all the time. Like here's a recent example from like just yesterday. What architecture is good for Swift UI? And here's my answer. This is the reason I wanted to show this, right? There's no blanket correct answer. The right question is, what's the best architecture for the needs of my specific project? And that's just the example of architecture. You could insert whatever question you have, you know, Swift UI versus UI kit, all that kind of stuff. It really depends on what your project is trying to achieve, but not only, you know, the code of the project, I think something a lot of people don't think about is your team. Like, what are the capabilities of your team? Just one example, say you're a small company and you start with just a very senior developer that builds your initial app. And because it's just them, they're senior, they know what they're doing, they use some complex architecture and build things very complex way because it makes sense to them. But because you're a small company, you can only afford junior developers in the future. So now you're bringing on these junior developers into this crazy complex code base using this very niche architecture. Those junior programmers are probably gonna hate their life for one, but two, you're gonna move as a development team so much slower than if you chose to use a more standard architecture and standard way of doing things, knowing you were gonna have junior developers coming in. And even that story right there is subjective. Like that's what Bruno says here, is that a lot of this stuff is largely subjective. So I just gave you my opinion on how I would handle a team that is expecting junior developers come in, but that's my subjective opinion. Someone could see it a totally different way and they wouldn't be wrong. Some common examples are this, like we talked about, SwiftUI versus UIKit, hybrid versus native. The hybrid versus native is a good one because, you know, as native developers, we like to shit on hybrid development because it does typically produce a lesser app than if you built it native. But it comes down to a business decision, right? Maybe you only have one developer and you have to support both platforms and you don't have the developer resources to build natively for both. Well, then it makes more business sense to say, yes, it is going to be a lesser app, but hybrid makes more sense for us versus if you have resources, you know, you want to build native. The answers to these questions are very specific to your project, your team, et cetera. You know, best practices, architecture, general advice. And then the last one I want to point out, you know, programming fundamentals. You know, do I need LeetCode as an iOS developer? Do I need to know data structures and algorithms? If you're applying to a FAANG company, you're gonna need that. If you're applying to a smaller startup, you're probably not gonna need that. So again, it always depends, right? That's the answer to everything in programming. It depends, and that's why I wanted to share this blog post, because so many people need to reread this. There is no right or wrong in software engineering. It all depends on your situation. Moving on, I want to share Paul Hudson's new repo called Inferno. And this is all about shaders in Swift UI. So here's the link to the repo, but I want to show you his YouTube video too, which I'll also link to, that shows the shaders in action and just some of the stuff you can do with Swift UI shaders. And there's like some pretty cool stuff. We'll see this animations. I think I saw somebody use this in like an onboarding, just as like a background for like an AI music thing. It looked cool. So a lot of fun, cool animation stuff you can do with Swift UI shaders. And Paul has a new library called Inferno that handles a lot of this stuff for you. And if you wanna learn more about it, Paul's got some good tutorials on his site. Sticking with YouTube, one of the big conferences in the Swift world, Swift Leads, released all their videos from their recent conference up on YouTube. And you can see some of the topics of the talk, right? Swift UI performance, a guide to store kit 2, Swift UI navigation demystified. There's another one with the enums, right? Enums are The Shit by Jesse Linden. That's a very good talk. I watched that. So there's a lot of good topics covered in these YouTube videos. They're about a half hour a piece. So definitely take the time to check them out. And the last YouTube video I wanted to share is a short video from Naval talking about, you know, AI replacing programmers. And I'll go back to that a little bit, right? He says, put another way, programmers are not these magical elves who have learned this secret esoteric ritual, which nobody else can learn or understand. Programmers are simply the people who are so dedicated to building software that they're willing to stay at the edge of their craft and learn to use every tool, no matter how sophisticated or complex it is. And basically, this is the answer to the question of, like, should we be worried about AI replacing us? Like, are programmers going to become obsolete? Like, that's the name of the YouTube video. And it's only 2.5 minutes long. Definitely watch the whole thing. You know, my take on it is old school programmers used to have to code what we call at the metals, like basic assembly language. And then we get layers on top of that. Like, for example, Swift UI is an easier to use layer on top of UIKit, right? All these layers get built on top of each other. Like, a programmer in the 80s would look at what we use now like we're spoiled brats, you know? So I just think this AI stuff is a tool and it's just like the next layer. Another point in the video he's making is that just the bar is gonna get raised, right? If anyone can build a basic app with no developer skills thanks to AI, well, that just raises the bar on what an app needs to be. And then us good programmers, right? If you consider yourself a good programmer, your skills are gonna have to elevate to create those better apps. And that's my take on the whole AI thing. I believe in my abilities to adapt to whatever this new world of programming is. And yeah, the bar is going to get raised. You're not gonna be able to have mediocre skills and build a mediocre app anymore, because everyone's gonna be able to do that to AI. So step your game up, basically. And to finish up this AI ChatGPT talk, another blog post from Bruno Rocha at Swift Rocks, how I'm using ChatGPT for software engineering. Just three little tips on how he uses it, on how you can start integrating it into your workflow. Because like I kind of just said, like, if you're not utilizing the help of ChatGPT, and I know it's not right all the time, it hallucinates, I'm not saying it's perfect, but I do think you need to start building the muscle of working with this, even if it's not fully ready for Swift UI yet, because Swift UI is so new and changing all the time, right? If you were working in like Objective-C or even like UIKit, I think ChatGPT, I say I think because I don't work in that, so I haven't done it, but I imagine because that's mature and all the content on the internet, I bet that would be Very, very helpful if you're working in those platforms. But anyway, the use cases Bruno talks about is, you know, I don't know what I'm looking for, because sometimes you don't even know what to Google. So you can kind of just give ChatGPT a rough thing and it'll spit out something helpful. Your question can be too specific for Google. You ever tried to Google some crazy specific error that Xcode gets you and you get no results from your search? ChatGPT can be good for that. And then you want answers fast, because like he says, Google with SEO and ads, sometimes finding the answer you're looking for, you know, can take a few different site visits, and ChatGPT can be a lot faster for that. So just some tips on how to use ChatGPT. Like I said, if you're working in SwiftUI, it might not be ready yet, but I still think you should start working that muscle. Now for the indie dev portion of the show, I have the 2023 Indie App Business Year in Review from Sebastian Roll. Sebastian makes the App Habit Kit, very active on Twitter. Definitely give him a follow if you're interested in indie development, but he made about 50 grand from, I think he has two apps, Habit Kit being the main one. But I wanted to point this out too for the indie developer journey, because he talks about the struggle in the beginning. Like, look at the revenue in January, February, March, April, May. You're hovering around 1.5 to 2.5K. It feels like you're spinning your wheels. Feels like you're, you know, nothing's working. And then maybe you get a little bump. And then look, you actually fall backwards in September. That can be demoralizing just when you think you get things on track. And then look what happens in October, November, December. The point is like with this indie dev stuff, constantly improving the product, constantly doing as much marketing as you can. I know that's hard for developers, but you spin your wheels, you spin your wheels, you spin your wheels. It feels like you're going nowhere. And then all of a sudden things click and it starts to happen. That this is like the classic story of getting a product up and running. So if you're interested in the indie dev world, definitely check out Sebastian's blog on his year in review. I really enjoyed reading it. Next up, Moving Parts partnered with Emerge Tools to make their POW transition library free. So let's go, here's the repo. Emerge Tools, POW, I'll link to this. I wanna show the README because it shows you how to use it, all the effects, haptic feedback, the jump, but what you wanna see, right? This is a visual show, you don't wanna look at code. Let's see these things in action. Well, I was already on Wiggle, so let's click Wiggle. You can see the answer button Wiggle. We're gonna go backwards here. Spray, you know, we like button, there's the spray, and this is all a bunch of like transitions. So here's a skid transition. Here's a shake one for, you know, when you enter a wrong password, the password will shake. Here's pop, this is a common one, you hit like, boom, there you go. Here's pulse, you can see the badge pulsing up there in the upper right. So a lot of fun flip, this feels like a very PowerPoint-y transition, but a lot of transitions and little fun animations. Like I really like this spray animation right here. When you hit the like button, all the hearts go up. So if you're looking to spruce up your app a little bit, definitely check out the repo called POW. It was by Moving Parts originally, but I don't know if Emerge Tools acquired them. I don't know all the details, but it used to cost money. Now it's free, so check it out. And lastly, I wanna show this off just because it's cool, to be honest. Marcus Eckert's been doing a lot of cool stuff with shaders and metal and iOS. So basically, the onboard screen, the more you don't use it, it like freezes over. And you see you wipe your thumb over it to thaw it out. I'll fast forward a little bit because it takes a little bit to freeze over. But as you sit there, it just slowly starts to freeze over. And it looks insanely realistic. I think that's super cool. Again, does it have a use? I don't know. It's just cool as hell. That wraps it up for this episode of Swift News. We'll see you in the next one.